So in the last class on unit 5, I have discussed about the BJT realization of different types of feedback topology. More specifically, we have discussed about the current series feedback using common emitter, small signal amplifier. Then I have discussed about the voltage shunt topology involving resistance connected between the collector and the base terminal. And finally, I have considered the current shunt topology, in which case you have two different amplifiers, two different common emitter amplifiers connected in cascade fashion, so as to have this current shunt kind of feedback. Now, out of those four different topologies, only one is left, that is the voltage series kind of thing, which we have not discussed so far, in terms of the BJT realization. Now, today, I'll start this discussion by considering the BJT realization of voltage series feedback. So as I've already discussed in the last class that apart from this current series and voltage shunt, if you want to realize this voltage series and current shunt, you require at least two stages of amplification. So for current series, we have already discussed that part. We have also discussed the voltage shunt topology. Now, today, let me start with discussing about the voltage series kind of thing using two single stage C amplifiers connected in cascade. So it becomes eventually a multi-stage amplifier. Now let me have the biasing arrangement as simple as possible. The simplest biasing arrangement I'm going to have. So this is the first stage. Now, to increase the stability, I've incorporated the emitter resistance over here. So let this be RB1, this be RC1. This is the first stage. Now let us consider the design of the second stage. So I can have two different options. The first option is that I can design the corresponding biasing circuits independently, in which case these two stages are connected by means of a coupling capacitor in between, or I can directly connect the first stage to the second stage. So here I prefer to design the biasing circuit separately. So for the second stage, I have a biasing circuit like this. So two stages are biased independently. So this is the resistance RB2, this is RC2. You can also use voltage divider kind of bias, no problem. Now this is RE1, as I've already mentioned. And this is RE2. Now, as you know, if I have this unbypassed emitter resistance, then it gives rise to a kind of current series feedback. Now, to avoid any local feedback, what I can do is I can make this local feedback inactive by means of a bypass capacitor, CE2. So there are two stages. So let me connect these two stages by means of a coupling capacitor. By means of this coupling capacitor, let me connect these two stages together. So this is the supply line, as you know, VCC. And we are taking the output from this terminal. This is the output voltage, VO, of the overall two-stage amplifier. And we have connected the input signal at this particular position. At the input, at the base of the first amplifier stage, by means of another coupling capacitor, for example. Let it be CC1. And this one is CC2. Now we are talking about the voltage series kind of feedback involving a multi-stage amplifier. So So as you know, we have to have this voltage series kind of feedback. So obviously, we need to take this output voltage at the input of the back network. Now, before discussing further, so this circuit is incomplete. So before discussing further, let me first draw the small signal equivalent circuit. Then you can connect the corresponding feedback elements. I believe I can draw it over here, or rather, it is better to start from this particular point. So the first stage is a common emitter amplifier with unbypassed emitter resistance. So initially, I should have this R pi 1 between B1 and E1. B1 and E1, I must have R pi 1. Then between C1 and E1, I should have this current source, GM1 times V pi 1. Then the output resistance of the transistor, that is RO1, R0 1. So this terminal is C1, collector 1. This terminal is E1, emitter 1. But remember, emitter 1 is not grounded because we have this RE1, this resistance is there. So in AC equivalent circuit, the potential at E1 is not equal to 0. So this is E1, emitter 1. I can also connect them together inside. Now collector 1 is connected to base 2. So by means of a coupling capacitor, now in small signal equivalent circuit, I may assume that the coupling capacitor is providing 0 impedance. So I can consider it to be short circuited. So this is connected to B2 of the second transistor. Now between B2 to E2, I should have R pi 2. So this is the terminal E2. This terminal is E2, which is essentially at ground potential because of this REC combination, because of the presence of the bypass capacitor. And then we have this one, GM2 times V pi 2, connected between C2 and E2, and RO2. So this terminal is C2. So let me once again mention, although it must be clear to you. So this is R pi 1. This is GM1 times V pi 1. This one is RO1. This resistance is R pi 2. This one is GM2 times V pi 2. And this is nothing but RO2. So these are the different elements of the small signal equivalent circuit. Now E2, as you know, because of the presence of this bypass capacitor, E2 is essentially at ground potential. So this is grounded. So this terminal is ground, is at ground potential. Now, okay, I have missed one part, this RC1 I have missed. So this RC1 is connected between C1 and ground, and E1 is not at ground potential, but E2 is at ground potential, so I can connect them together. So this one is RC1. This is RC1. E2 is at ground potential. Now what is left? RC2 is left. You can also incorporate RB1 and RB2 accordingly, which are connected between base to ground for B1 and B2 respectively. Now I am introducing this RC2, which is connected between C2 to ground, because one terminal of RC2 is at C2 and the other terminal is at VCC. So in the small signal equivalent circuit, it is connected between C2 and ground, and E2 is essentially at ground potential. So I can join them together, and this terminal is the ground potential. This is the ground terminal. So E2 is at ground potential because we have this RE2 CE2 combination. Now, assuming that at the signal frequency, this bypass capacitor is providing a very small reactance so that it can be considered to be a short circuited. So that's why this terminal E2 is at ground potential in the small signal equivalent circuit or AC equivalent circuit, which we have already discussed in the previous module. Now this is your RC2. Now I have to introduce RE1 in this circuit. So how this RE1 is connected? This RE1 is connected between emitter 1, E1 to ground. So this is connected between E1 to ground. And obviously RE2 will not be there in the small signal equivalent circuit because the effect of RE2 is not there by virtue of the presence of the CE2 or bypass capacitor. Although this circuit is incomplete, I need to incorporate the feedback element which are there. Now, before that, let me try to understand how this RE1 is connected. So had this been the ground line, let me consider this is the ground line. This is the ground line. So E1 is not at ground potential. E1 is at some potential and it is connected to ground through RE1. So what I can do is, I can show this RE1 resistance in the small signal equivalent circuit by virtue of this. So this is at the ground potential. This is at ground potential. So E1 is connected to ground potential through RE1, so which has been already incorporated over here. Now, this part is not completed, the input side of the back network. So already we are trying to incorporate another resistance, feedback resistance, so that ultimate circuit looks like a voltage series kind of thing. So as you understand, let me first write it down. What type of feedback we are looking for? We are looking for voltage series, because the other three types of feedback topology has already been discussed in the last class. So we are looking for voltage series kind of feedback. Voltage series. So sampling must be done in the output side, and the voltage sampling is done over here. So how do we perform this voltage sampling? By connecting something in shunt path. So what I can do is, so this is the output voltage VO. We have to sample this output voltage and we need to feed it back at the input of the back network in a shunt path because we are sampling the voltage. So if you want to connect the shunt combination, so it will be something like that. Now this is connected to the back network by virtue of this resistance. So we have not connected it yet in the actual circuit. And as you know, this terminal is at ground potential, so I can directly connect it over here. Because as you know, this E2 is at ground potential, so I can do that. So this is the resistance RF. Now, how is RF connected? One terminal is connected at C2. If I just look at the small signal equivalent circuit, you'll find that one terminal of RF is connected at C2 and the other terminal is connected at E1. So in this way, RF is connected. So I can easily incorporate this one in the small signal equivalent circuit. So it is connected between C2 and E1. Just like this, although the circuit is a little bit clumsy. So this is connected between C2, the output terminal of the overall amplifier, with E1. Sometimes, in order to ensure that the biasing is not hampered by means of this connection, you can also incorporate one capacitor over here so that the biasing is not hampered at all. So anyway, so this RF is connected in this fashion from collector 2 to E1. Of the first transistor or first amplifier. And let us have a look at this small signal which we are applying at the input side. So this is connected between B1 and ground. So small signal is connected between B1 and ground. This is VS, for example. So this terminal is ground, as you know. and the other terminal is connected to B1, just like this. So if I take a look at this part, it will be better if I just mark the different networks. So this is your back network, which receives the output voltage as its input, and it develops some feedback voltage over here. So this is the back network involving of two different resistances, RF and RE1. This is the back network, and this part is the feed network, incorporating the internal parameters of transistor and some biasing resistances. This RPi1, RPi2, RO1, RO2, and RC1, RC2. So all these things will make this feed network complete. So I have drawn two different boxes, one for feed network, the upper box, and this one for the back network. Now, once again, let us take a look the way the sampling and mixing operation is performed. So we are taking the output voltage at the input of the back network in shunt path. So voltage sampling is performed over here. This is the two output terminals. This one, this point, this terminal, and this terminal. So these are the two output terminals, and we are taking the connection in shunt path in parallel. And this is fed to the back network at the input of the back network. So therefore, this is the kind of voltage sampling. And how are we mixing it? We are mixing it in series path. We are mixing it in series path because if that voltage developed over here, if I refer that voltage equal to Vf, and if this voltage across B1 and E1, if this voltage equal to, say, for example, Vin or Vpi, then one can readily write that Vin is equal to Vs minus Vf, as apparent from the KVL. Vs is equal to Vin plus Vf, or Vin is equal to Vs minus Vf. So kind of negative feedback is developed. And how are we mixing? We are mixing in series path. So as we are mixing in series path, so it's a kind of voltage feedback. So we are feeding the voltage. So Vo is developed over here, and Vf is developed at the output of the back network. So Vo is the input to the back network, and Vf is the output of the back network. So I can readily write down the expression, which involves Vf and Vo. So what is Vf? Vf is nothing but RE1 upon RF plus RE1 times Vo. So from that, you can readily identify what is the feedback factor. So feedback factor B is given by RE1 upon RF plus RE1. So this is the feedback factor, RF plus RE1. RE1 by RF plus RE1 is the feedback factor. Now, once again, it's a kind of voltage series because the sampling is done at the output side and the mixing is performed in series path. So it's a voltage series, shunt sampling, and series mixing. Voltage series, in some other literature, we can also find that particular topology as shunt series kind of thing, because shunt sampling and series mixing. Now, for the feed network, both the input and the output variables are voltages. Input side, we're feeding the voltage. Output side, we're also getting the voltage. So it's a kind of voltage amplifier. Both the input and the output, they are voltages. So if A itself is unitless, it's a voltage amplifier, AV, if I mention, then the overall gain with feedback, I can write this like AV by 1 plus AVB. Now, both AV and B, they are unitless over here because AV is having no unit because it's a kind of voltage gain. Some 100, 200, just like this. Similarly, B is also unitless, as you can see from this particular expression, that it is nothing but the ratio of two different resistances, RE1 upon RF plus RE1. Now, under the condition when AV is very, very large, if AV is very, very large than 1 or so, it's very, very large, then I can always write this expression like this, 1 by 1 upon AV plus B. And under the condition AV is very, very large, then that can be approximated to 0, and AVF can be approximated to 1 upon B. What is 1 upon B over here? So this is nothing but 1 plus RF by RE1. So ultimately, the gain with feedback is no longer dependent upon the transistor internal parameters. If you can select these two parameters, this RE1 and this RF, if you can select them wisely, then also you can control the overall gain with feedback. So this is a kind of voltage series type of feedback. Now, once again, since the sampling is performed in the shunt mode or parallel sampling is done, and the mixing is done in the series mode. So therefore, the input impedance of this type of amplifier must be very large, because we are making a series kind of mixing and the sampling is done in the shunt path. So output impedance will be very small. So for this type of amplifier, input impedance Rin is very large. Large Rin we are getting over here because of series type of mixing. So large Rin I will be getting, and small RO or small Rout. So which is essentially the property of a common collector amplifier. If you can recall it properly from our discussion in unit 3, you must readily connect this particular property of two-stage amplifier, two-stage common unit amplifier, with that of a common collector amplifier. For common collector amplifier, the input impedance is very large and the output impedance is very small. So once again, the next question which might arise in your mind is that whether we can develop any common collector amplifier in such a way that it provides the kind of voltage series type of feedback. I have also raised a similar type of question in the last day, that for a current shunt type of feedback, can it be possible to realize a current shunt feedback using a common base amplifier? Because for current shunt type of feedback, the input impedance was small and the output impedance was large, which is essentially the property of a common base amplifier. So if I just go back, so the one was left, this voltage series, which we have completed today, voltage series type of feedback. We have readily identified that the input impedance is large and the output impedance is small. A is nothing but AV and B is unitless. So all these four types of feedback amplifiers have been discussed so far using common emitter topology only. But it is also possible to realize this voltage series type of feedback using a single stage common collector amplifier. And it is also possible to realize, just by observing the Rin Rout combination, which resembles with that of CC and CB respectively. So it is also possible to realize current shunt by means of CB amplifier. Now let us have a look whether this is possible or not, and if yes, then how is it possible? So let me start the discussion with a common collector amplifier. So I'm just drawing the very fundamental circuit involving simple biasing arrangement. This is a very fundamental biasing arrangement for a common collector. So you're applying the input at the base. This input we are applying over here. This is the coupling capacitor, RB. This is the supply line, VCC. And RE1 is there, or RE, I must say, because only one stage, so RE is good enough. And we are taking the output from this terminal. As you know, this is known also as an emitter follower, common collector and emitter follower. So this is the supply, the signal source, VS. Now let us draw the small signal equivalent circuit and try to establish whether this involves a kind of voltage series feedback or not. So to start with, I must draw the equivalent circuit for a transistor itself. So here the input is applied between base and collector, because collector is the common terminal over here. So if this is the base terminal, so from there will be a resistance RB over here. This resistance RB over there between base and ground, because collector is at ground. So I can also consider this terminal as a collector terminal. Now between base to emitter, we must have R pi resistance. This is R pi, which is connected between base to emitter. And between collector to emitter, we should have GM times V pi. GM times V pi. And there is an R naught. So this is the collector terminal. This is the collector terminal. This is also the collector terminal. So I can connect them together. So collector is essentially at ground potential. So this is the emitter terminal. This is RO. Now already we have incorporated RB in this particular small signal equivalent model, but RE has not been shown over here. So how is RE connected? So RE is connected between the emitter terminal to the ground terminal. So between emitter and ground, we find that RE is present. So this is the base. So we are applying the signal, small signal between base and the ground. So this terminal is at ground potential. This is Vs, if I write like this. So this is the emitter terminal. So let me consider this is my ground line. This is the ground line, for example. So this is the output voltage V0. So this is connected in between E and the ground. But as you know, collector is already at ground potential. So what I can do is I can make a connection like this. I can make a connection like this because this RE is connected in between emitter and ground, but collector is already at ground potential because of this common collector kind of thing. So I can make a connection like this. Other terminal of VS is essentially connected to ground. So if this is my ground line, then I can directly connect these two terminals together. And similarly, collector is at ground, so I can make this connection. Now let us have a look. What about this? This is the back network. This is the back network. And the upper one is the feed network. So since it's a single stage kind of thing, so the circuit is not that much complicated, unlike a two stage amplifier. So this is the back network. The lower one is the back network. And the upper one is a feed network. Once again, let us take a look how the sampling and mixing operation is performed. So we are performing the sampling in the shunt path, in parallel path we have connected like this. So the sampling is a voltage sampling. And how are we mixing? We are mixing it in series. So we have just cut the loop at the input side and we have inserted the output of the back network in series with the input signal Vs. So ultimately, this particular circuit demonstrates a kind of voltage series feedback involving a common collector amplifier, voltage series. So what is the voltage applied at the input of the back network, that is V0? What is the voltage developed at the output of the back network, the feedback voltage, that is VF? Now, as you see, if I assume that this difference is very small, so V naught and Vf, they are eventually very much close to each other. So under this condition, because here we are sampling the voltage and we are also mixing the voltage, so the feedback factor, what we are getting over here, feedback factor B is eventually 1. B is eventually 1 feedback factor. If I assume that this difference is very small, then what about the total gain with feedback? The gain with feedback, once again, since it's a voltage series kind of feedback, so I should consider the voltage gain only, AVF. So what is the voltage gain with feedback? So for the feed network, if that voltage gain is AV, and for the back network, if this is B, so it will be nothing but AV by 1 plus AVB. Now under the condition that B is equal to 1, so I can write this by AV upon 1 plus AV. Now for very high value of the voltage gain, so this is very much close to 1, but somewhat less than 1. If I assume that AV is very large, like 100 or 150, so it will be like close to 0.99, 0.98. So under this condition, AVF is very much close to 1. Now this you can also verify from your knowledge on common collector circuit. Now what happens for common collector circuit? During the discussion, I have already mentioned that for common collector circuit, it's known as the voltage buffer, an emitter follower, because for a common collector circuit, the voltage gain is always less than unity. Under ideal condition, it is close to unity or close to 1, but otherwise the value is less than 1. So this can also be verified from this expression of feedback given by AV upon 1 plus AVB. Now under the condition B is equal to 1, so it will be close to AV by 1 plus AV. Now for high value of AV, this is close to 1, which you normally obtain for common collector amplifier, without knowing that for any common collector amplifier, there is an explicit feedback present by virtue of the resistance RE. And because of that, the feedback factor is equal to 1. So from this discussion, we can conclude that a common collector amplifier is always capable to provide a kind of voltage series types of feedback. You can also verify that since the sampling is performed in the shunt path, so the output resistance will be reduced to some extent. And since the mixing is performed in the series path, so the input resistance will be large, so which is the property of a common collector amplifier. Now, one other type is left, that is the common base amplifier, and whether this common base amplifier is able to show a kind of current shunt types of feedback or not. So for this, let me start with a common base amplifier. So for common base amplifier, let us consider the circuit like this. We are applying the input at the emitter terminal. So this is essentially at ground potential. By virtue of this capacitor, we are making this at ground potential. Now we are applying the input at this particular terminal, at emitter terminal, and we are getting the output from this particular terminal. So this is the supply VCC, this one is RC, this one is RB, and this one is RE. So this is a very simplest model of common base amplifier involving very fundamental biasing elements. Only RB is there, nothing else. Now to draw the corresponding equivalent circuit, first of all, the input is applied between emitter to base. So since the input is applied between emitter to base, I can consider this terminal as emitter terminal, and base is at AC ground, and this resistance is R pi. And as you know, between collector to emitter, there is a GM V pi term. Now here, for a common base amplifier, normally we refer like V pi is equal to VB minus VE, which is nothing but the voltage drop between base and emitter, or VB minus V like this. Now here, VB is essentially at ground potential. The small signal equivalent circuit, this value is at 0. So therefore, V pi itself here is negative. So V pi equal to minus V e. So under this condition, the direction of the current will be just opposite, because V pi is negative over here. So this is the GM V pi. And if you wish, you can also incorporate this R naught, which is typically very large, the output resistance of the transistor itself. So this one is the collector terminal. This is the base terminal. Now RB will not be there in the small signal equivalent circuit, because one end is at AC ground, other end is at VCC, which is also AC ground. So RB will not be there. So there will be no small signal current flowing through RB. Now how to connect RC? RC is connected between collector terminal and ground, because VCC is at ground potential, small signal equivalent circuit. So that is fine. Now we need to incorporate RE in the small signal equivalent model, which is connected between emitter and ground. So RE is connected between emitter and ground. So if this is my ground line and this is the emitter terminal, so I can connect this one. I can connect this one, this RE, between emitter to ground. So this connection I'm showing explicitly. This is the ground line, so RE is connected in between. This terminal is essentially at ground potential, so what I can do is I can also eliminate this part. In other way, I can also show the same thing. RC, which is connected over here. RC is connected over here. So it's a kind of current shunt feedback. So let me write it down first. And then you can understand the way you have to find out the mixing and sampling operation. It's a current shunt type of feedback. Current shunt. So I need to break this loop. I need to break the output loop, and accordingly, this is connected. So this is also possible, because this is at ground potential, this terminal. Instead of connecting over here, I can also connect it over here. No problem, because this terminal, this base terminal, is at ground. So this is the resistance RE. And since this particular terminal is at ground potential, so I can connect it together over here, just like this. What about the signal source? So signal source is connected between emitter to ground. One terminal is at E and the other terminal is at ground. So I can connect this one between this. So this is the signal source. Now, because of the shunt connection, I can regard the signal source as a current source over here. Now, for the feed network, the mixing is performed in the shunt path. Mixing is performed in the shunt path. This is the feed network. This one is RC. And The back network I'm representing by means of a different color, green color, back network. So for which the applied input is the current input over here. So it's a current sampling, I can say, the current sampling. And the feedback current is essentially the output current IO. If the current IO is over here, which is flowing in this way, this is the direction of the current, IO, output current. So IO and IF being the same. So IO is equal to IF, the feedback current and output current being the same. So for the back network, here for the back network, both the input as well as the output is current. So input is IO, output is IF. So both of them are current. So the corresponding feedback factor is unitless. And under the condition that IO equal to IF, the feedback factor B becomes 1. And what about the overall amplifier? For this amplifier, the input is the current, output is also the current. So the overall amplifier is a kind of current amplifier. So for which I can write AIF is equal to AI upon 1 plus AI into B. So following the same analogy, I can write this current gain equal to AI by 1 plus AI. Now, when this current gain of the feed network is very large with respect to 1, then I can approximate the current gain to be close to 1, but it will be less than 1. So for feed network, if the current gain is given by HFE or beta, then it is given by the overall current gain, AIF, is given by beta by 1 plus beta, so which is equal to our good known alpha. So current gain over here, AIF, is equal to alpha, where alpha is equal to beta upon 1 by beta. Beta upon 1 by beta. So alpha is the common base current gain, as you know. So once again, if you recall our discussion of common base amplifier, so you know for common base amplifier, the corresponding voltage gain is typically large in the order of GM times RC. But the current gain, which is the ratio between the output current and the input current, so here for a common base amplifier, the output current is the collector current and the input current is emitter current. So emitter current, as you know, emitter current IE is equal to IB plus IC. So if I just find out the ratio between IC upon IE, so that ratio is always less than 1 by virtue of non-zero IB. And the ratio of IC and IE is known as the common base current gain, that is alpha. So while considering the common base kind of amplifier, a single stage common base amplifier, you never understood that whether the implicit feedback is present here or not. But if I can extract the feed network and the back network separately from a common base amplifier, then you must appreciate that there is also a kind of current shunt feedback playing a pivotal role in controlling the overall voltage gain or overall current gain of such an amplifier. So voltage gain will be applicable for a voltage series kind of feedback, for which we have seen that just now, that the voltage gain is given by AV by 1 plus AV, just like this. For this amplifier, a voltage series amplifier, a common collector amplifier known as the voltage buffer or emitter follower, for which the voltage gain is less than 1. And similarly, for a common base amplifier, we have seen that it's a kind of current shunt feedback. It provides a kind of current shunt feedback with a feedback factor equal to 1, which is unlikely, because normally for any feedback circuit, we expect that this B value, this feedback factor, is always less than 1, like 0.1 or 0.2. But here, both for this common base and common collector, if I want to represent the current shunt or voltage series type of feedback, then we find that the feedback factor is equal to 1 for this circuit, for the simplest circuit, and for which we can easily find out the overall voltage gain with feedback or overall current gain with feedback. Now, so far we have discussed about the stability of any feedback amplifier circuit. Now, apart from stability, there is another important issue which we have discussed in the unit 4, that is the frequency response characteristics of any amplifier. So for the feedback amplifier, it also plays some role in controlling the bandwidth of any amplifier. So for any amplifier, if I represent the corresponding gain as a function of frequency, so I can write AS equal to, for example, this is given by A0 by 1 plus S by some omega H. So what does it mean is that the corresponding a voltage gain is a function of frequency. It's no longer constant. So had this been not a function of frequency, so in that case, it will be A naught, A is equal to A naught, which is typically true when AC is very small. If AC is very small with respect to this omega H, then you can say that AC is equal to A0, which is known as the low frequency gain. But as the value of AC or frequency increases, then the corresponding value of AC, that means the gain with as a function of frequency, will reduce. So as a matter of fact, I can visualize this particular transfer function. If I write this as my frequency omega, and if this is the gain, mod of the gain, then it is something like that. Initially, the value is constant at A0, then it drops because there is only one pole, so the value will drop like this. Now, I have to identify this point where the gain value is 3 dB less as compared to the peak value. So this is nothing but at AC is equal to omega H, if I put AC is equal to omega H, if the corresponding frequency is equal to the higher cutoff frequency, then you must understand that A j omega mod of this is equal to A naught, that is a constant term, divided by root over of 1 plus omega by omega H whole square, because I have to represent this by A plus JB in this form, and what about the magnitude of A plus JB? Nothing but root over of A square plus B square. So omega plus omega H whole square like this. So at omega equal to omega H, what we find is at omega equal to omega H, we find is A J omega mod of this is nothing but A naught upon root 2. This is 3 dB less, and that particular frequency is known as the cutoff frequency, 3 dB cutoff frequency omega H. Now for the amplifier for which there is no such feedback, so I can easily find out the corresponding higher cutoff frequency is given by omega H. But suppose with this feed network, this AS, if I connect another back network, just like a feedback amplifier, if I connect like this, already you know that what will be the impact of the gain. The gain will be drastically reduced by the desensitivity factor. But what about the higher cutoff frequency? Will there be any change in the higher cutoff frequency? Now let us take a look. So with feedback, I can write this AFS with feedback is given by AS upon 1 plus AS into B. So what is AS? AS already we have established by A naught upon 1 by S by omega H. And this one is 1 by S by omega H into B. If I multiply both the numerator and the denominator by 1 plus S by omega H, then it will become A naught. Then we have 1 upon one plus S by omega H plus A naught B. So once again, if I multiply with omega H, I can take one plus A naught B common. Then it will become 1 plus S by omega H into 1 plus A naught B. So ultimately, with feedback, the expression looks something like that, AFS. With feedback, the expression is something like that, A naught upon 1 plus A naught B, multiplied with 1 by 1 plus S by omega H into 1 plus A naught B. So if I regard this one, this A naught upon 1 plus A naught B as A naught if, then this is given by 1 plus S by omega H F. So we have introduced two different parameter, A naught if, which is equal to A naught upon 1 plus A naught B. And the second one is omega HF, which is equal to omega H into 1 plus A naught B. So the description of the first part is already known to us, that if I incorporate a kind of feedback, then the low frequency gain will be reduced by the desensitivity factor. So initially, for this particular amplifier, this gain was like A naught. This value was A naught. At low frequency, the value was A naught, and the corresponding higher cutoff frequency was omega H. But as soon as we make a connection like this, as soon as we connect a back network along with this AS, along with this feed network, then eventually the low frequency gain will be reduced, which we have discussed so far, that A naught upon 1 plus A naught B, which is nothing but the desensitivity factor. Now, what about the corresponding higher cutoff frequency? If I compare this one, if I compare the same expression, you'll see that this higher cutoff frequency is given by omega H multiplied with 1 plus A naught B. So the gain value is reduced. So this is known as gain sensitivity, which we have already seen. And this one is known as bandwidth extension. So these are the two essential properties of any feedback amplifier. The first part has already been discussed. Gain will be much more sensitive, but the bandwidth will also be extended. On the other hand, if you calculate the gain bandwidth product, this gain bandwidth product will be constant throughout, whether you incorporate feedback or not. So graphically, I can show the same thing. So this is omega, for example, the frequency axis. This is the gain axis. So with feedback and without feedback, there are two different conditions. Suppose this is a scenario without feedback. So this is A naught. And this value is, suppose, 3 dB less. Known as omega H. Now, as soon as you connect the back network, then it is something like that. Suppose it is something like that. So here, this value is given by A naught upon 1 plus A naught B. The gain has been reduced drastically, the low frequency gain. And if I want to compute the corresponding higher cutoff frequency, this omega H F, this is extended by the factor 1 plus A naught into. So these are the two essential properties of any feedback amplifier. One is the gain sensitivity, which we have already discussed in the very first class on unit 5. And today I have just mentioned about the bandwidth extension of any feedback amplifier. Once again, if you have any feed network and if you connect any back network in a proper connection, a proper mode, then you will find that the gain will be reduced. Gain will be much more stable with respect to the temperature fluctuation or any other fluctuations. But at the same time, the bandwidth is also be extended. So for the design of any practical amplifier, we want that the gain should be stable, gain should be very large, and the bandwidth should be very high. But all these properties, although all of them are desirable properties, but all of these properties are not attained simultaneously. For the circuit without feedback, you can have very high gain, but it is much less stable. Bandwidth may be extended to some extent. For a common base amplifier, you have seen that the bandwidth is extended, but at the cost of lower gain, because once you make any attempt to connect a common base amplifier with any voltage source or so, then you'll see that because of a very low input resistance of a common base amplifier, the effective value of the overall voltage gain is drastically reduced. On the other hand, if you consider a common emitter amplifier, for which case you will find that the corresponding voltage gain is pretty large, in the order of few GM times RC or so, but the corresponding bandwidth is relatively limited because of the Miller capacitances. On the other hand, if you have a combination like common emitter, common base cascode, for which case you can have both high gain as well as very high bandwidth, but at the cost of doubling the overall hardware, total hardware. And on the other hand, if I consider a common emitter amplifier under two conditions, a common emitter amplifier without the bypass capacitance, if I consider, we have RE resistance without bypass capacitance, then it will be a stable one, but the gain will be pretty much less, because under this condition, when the emitter terminal is connected to ground through a resistance RE, which is unbypassed, then the circuit involves a kind of feedback, which we have already discussed, and that feedback is known as a current series kind of feedback. So we get a circuit with much more stable gain, but at the cost of lower gain, because you know, for circuit with unbypassed emitter resistance, the corresponding gain value is given by RC upon RE, which is much, much less as compared to GM times RC. Once you make any attempt to incorporate the stability issue as well within the paradigm of a common emitter amplifier, then you have to remove this RE, which is not totally possible, because if you want to remove the RE, the emitter resistance, between this emitter terminal and the ground terminal, then the circuit becomes unstable. So the other option that is left with you to connect a bypass capacitor in shunt with the resistance RE, in which case the DC stability is ascertained, and at the same time the corresponding gain is also increased. But once you make any attempt to connect a bypass capacitor in shunt with the resistance RE, then the feedback is, the notion of feedback is eliminated, but you need to consider the effect of this bypass capacitor, or the frequency response of the bypass capacitor cannot be neglected to some extent. So that's why, in order to ensure that the corresponding cutoff frequency must not affect with that of normal coupling capacitor, so a typical value of the bypass capacitor is chosen like few hundreds of microfarads, so that it must not affect the cutoff frequency of resulting from this coupling capacitor. So we have discussed this thing in much more detail in unit 4 or so. Now with this, I think our discussion on unit 5 is completed. Now I would like to complete this session on unit 5.